قد عظمت فللأمجاد بانيها ومن يسعى إلى العلي.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين. Okay, welcome back everyone to Hearts Redeemed, Tafsir Surah At-Tawbah. We are on verse 93. I hope everyone is doing great. Looking forward to class today. It seems like it's been over a week, but it's been just a week, alhamdulillah. Okay, so let's look at verse number 93. بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. إنما, indeed, السبيل here meaning to take to task or there being reason for blame. على, upon, الذين, those, يستأذنونك, seek permission from you, و, and whom they, أغنياء, rich or wealthy. Radu, they are pleased, bi an, ba literally means with, an that. With that, yani, they're okay with, what are they okay with? That yakunu, that they would be among, ma'a, or with, that they would be with al khawalif. Al khawalif here referring to the women folk who are not obligated to go forth for battle. وَطَبَعَ, and stamped Allah. Allah has stamped عَلَى upon قُلُوبِهِمْ, their hearts. فَهُمْ, so they, لَا, do not, يَعْلَمُونَ, they do not know. Okay, so that's verse 93. But there are grounds for reproach against those who seek leave to stay behind, even though they are affluent. They are the ones who were content to be with the women folk who stay behind. Okay, so here we see the blame is not upon those that are sick and physically unable to go forth or financially constricted from going forth, as we had covered last week. But the ones that are to blame are the ones that are pointed out in this verse, who are affluent, they have the means, they're physically able, yet they are making excuses, seeking permission to stay behind with the women folk, with those that were not obligated to go forth for the battle. So this is where or when a person becomes blameworthy, is when you seek to get out of a situation where you are needed while you are perfectly capable of discharging that duty and are able to fulfill that duty. So this is something for us to keep in mind, that this is when we become blameworthy in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we have the capacity physically or financially and there is a situation of need, but we would still seek to wiggle ourselves out of that situation. And Shaykh Saadi rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions in his tafsir the reason they were content in this, and in this state, was actually the state their hearts were in, that they had been sealed over. And once the hearts become sealed over, then no khair, no goodness can enter it. They were not aware of this punishment that was inflicted upon them by the sealing of the hearts. And the reason they were receiving this punishment, he says, is on account of their actions that they themselves had chosen to willingly stay behind. So they no longer knew, after the sealing of their hearts, where their true interests lay in this world or in the next world, right? So yes, they were aware of their financial interests. They thought they were going after those and securing those, but really their interests, even within this world, lay in pursuing a course that would have benefited their akhirah. So this is what he means about them losing sight of those things that are truly beneficial to them. And this is a direct result of their hearts being sealed over, as is mentioned in this verse. Now, one of the worst conditions of the heart, or one of the worst states a person can be in, is when they don't recognize, they lose the ability to recognize and distinguish between good and evil. And this, in fact, is the beginning of the punishment in this world, the blinding of the hearts, which actually, is a foreboding of the blinding of these individuals in the hereafter, the physical blinding that will occur to them in the hereafter, as recorded in Surah Taha, verses 125 through 126, when the individual will say, قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا قَالَ كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَهَا وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى, which means, they will cry, my Lord, why have you raised me a blind, although I used to see? Allah will say, thus did our signs come to you and you forgot them and you disregarded them, and thus today you will be forgotten. So طبعه, the sealing of the hearts, actually linguistically also refers to something when it reaches its utmost point, reaches its extreme point. And it also refers to a seal, like when a bottle is filled, it reaches its utmost point, no more can be put into it, it is sealed, right? So here, this is the sealing of their hearts after they had reached that utmost point in their hypocrisy, in their lagging behind, in their constant attacks against Islam. And so this seal came over their hearts. And the way we can apply this to us, really insightful point I was listening to in the seed of this verse, is that when we continuously neglect a task that we know we're supposed to do, and at one point it was very important to us, and it was, you know, perhaps even a priority for us, you know, really high on our to-do list, and we neglect that task, slowly over time what happens is that the very importance of that task begins to diminish in our sight. Why? Because we have neglected it for so long. We have just let it, be on the back burner and been so aloof to it for so long that it no longer seems as important as it once did, and to the point that we even scratch off sometimes those tasks off the to-do list altogether, right? So it's the same when it comes to working for Allah's deen, being proactive in your Islam, right? When we become negligent of working for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or advancing our spirituality, it eventually begins to feel like it's something that we can do without. But that is not a truthful reality. That is not the truth. It's just that it begins to seem that way to us because our hearts are becoming muddy. The waters are becoming murky. We're beginning to see with less clarity. So it seems like, you know, this task is not as important as it used to be. So again, this is a red flag when something that was very important for our spiritual and Islamic development, if we then, because of just neglecting it over time, it seems less important. It's time to question and reassess our approach to it. Okay, let's look at verse 94. يَعْتَذِرُونَ, this is again, they make excuses from عُذْر, which is an excuse. إِلَيْكُمْ, to you or before you, إِذَا, when رَجَعْتُمْ, you return to them, إِلَيْهِمْ, to them. رَجَعْتُمْ, you return, إِلَيْهِمْ, to them. قُلْ, say, لَا, do not تَعْتَذِرُ, do not give excuses. لَن, we shall not, نُؤْمِنَ, believe. Okay, لَن, shall not believe, لَكُمْ, to you, يعني we shall not believe you. قَدْ, indeed, نَبَّأَنَا اللَّهُ, Allah has informed us, من, from, أخباركم, your أخبار, your news, يعني with regards to you, about you, Allah has informed us. Wa, and سيرى, shall see, Allah, Allah shall see, what, عملكم, your actions, ورسوله, and his messenger, يعني shall see your actions as well. ثم, then, تردون, you shall be returned, إلى, to, عالم, the knower, الغيب, of the unseen, والشهادة, and that which is seen. Fa, so yunabbi'ukum, he shall inform you, bima, with regards to that, kuntum, you used to, ta'amalun, you used to do. Verse 94, they will put up excuses before you when you return to them. Tell them, make no excuses, we will not believe you. Allah has already informed us of the truth about you. Allah will observe your conduct, and so will his messenger. Then you'll be brought back to him who knows alike what lies beyond perception and what lies in the range of perception, yani the seen and the unseen, and will let you know what you have done. Okay, verse 94. So again, here we are being told that when you return to them, yani they're going to, talking to Allah, talking to the Rasul, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when you and your Sahaba return back to Medina after Tabuk, these hypocrites who did not come with you are going to come and present their excuses. You're going to receive the same old excuses from them. Again, there's no reality to back them up. Now, there were about 80 hypocrites or so that had stayed behind in Medina, and the Rasul was after this point told not to sit with them, not to talk, not to socially engage with them. And this was also the instruction given to the Sahaba, to the believers. And simply instructed to tell them, there's no way we are going to believe you. The truest of the true has informed us. Our Lord has already informed us about your reality, right? Min akhbarikum, from your akhbar, from your news, or your khabar is a piece of news, right? So here, yani, we know all about you. We know what is really going on. And what counts are your actions. They are what count and speak louder than these excuses that you are presenting. And these actions, you lagging behind, you staying back, it's something you did publicly. It is plain for all to see. So this openly speaks of your nifaq, of your hypocrisy. So, you know, the reasons you are presenting are simply lies. But again, the munafiqeen were not killed for their treachery, right? The Rasul adopted the approach of, although he eventually came to know, obviously, who the hypocrites were, he did not kill them, right? He did not want it to be said that Muhammad kills his companions, because outwardly they were people who said La ilaha illallah, right? So they were treated according to their outward. And this verse is saying that you shall be returned to the alimul ghayb, right? To the knower of the unseen as well as the seen, wa shahada. And he is going to deal with you according to your realities, because for him, the open and the hidden are all the same. Okay, let's look at 95. Sayahlifuna, they shall swear billahi, by Allah, lakum, for you. Idhan qalabatum, idha, when inqalabatum, idhan qalabatum, yani when you return إليهم, to them, لِيَتُعْرِضُوا, in order that you would turn away عَنْهُمْ, from them. فَأَعْرِضُوا, so turn away عَنْهُمْ, from them. إِنَّهُمْ, indeed, they rijs are filth. وَمَأْوَاهُمْ, and their destination, جَهَنَّمْ, is the hell. جَزَاءً, a recompense, بِمَا, for that, كَانُوا, they used to, يَكْسِبُون, they used to do. Okay, verse number 95. When you return to them, they will surely swear to you in the name of Allah, so that you may leave them alone. So do leave them alone. They are unclean. Hell shall be their home, a recompense for what they did. Okay, so they are relying upon their excuses. The reason they're swearing falsely in Allah's name before you is that you would just kind of leave them alone, believe them, not take them to task for their actions, you know, become convinced by their swearing as to why they couldn't go. And they just want to explain themselves convincingly through these oaths that they were taking in the name of God. And this verse is saying, you know, they're doing swearing falsely, right, by in Allah's name, so that you would leave them alone. Well, you can leave them alone. You're totally free to leave them alone, because they are rijs, they are impure, they are like, you know, they are filthy, they are not worth your time and your effort. Maududi rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions in the seed of this, he says the Arabic words are of the same root, fa'aridu, referring to a'aridu, right? But they have different senses in the two sentences in which they occur, right? You'll see that the same word occurs, a'aridu, twice in this verse. So they have the same root, but they're used slightly differently. So in the first sentence, it means that they are swearing in Allah's name so that you may turn away from them, right? So that you may be forbearing towards them, so that you may not take them to task, so you may forgive them, and you know they will look all good and absolved in your eyes, right? And then Allah says, فَأَعْرِضُ عَنْهُمْ. So turn away from them. The same word is used again. This time Allah is saying it toward to the believers, that so turn away from them. So here it means, yani, turn away from them in the sense that break away from them. Break your connections with them. Have nothing to do with them, as if you have, you know, you have nothing to do with them, they have nothing to do with you. In that sense, just break away, because they are indeed rids, they are indeed impure because of their actions and their lies. Ibn Kathir mentions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that the hypocrites will swear to the believers an apology so that the believers turn away from them without admonishing them, right? This is the purpose for which they were swearing. They just wanted to have the believers, you know, treat them in a way that was soft and forbearing, and just turning away in a forbearing way, not becoming convinced of their lies or their oaths, rather. Now here the word rijs is used. It means the same thing as najis, which is impurity, right? And we saw earlier in this surah that the word najis, which is the same meaning as rijs, which mean they both mean impurity, right, is also used in this surah for the mushrikeen, right? So basically, you know, it's the same thing. These munafiqeen were the rich, well-to-do, affluent people of Medina. No one would think of them, you know, if they saw them and knew of their status and their position, no one would think of them as rids, as impurity. But they are this because of the state of their hearts. And this reminds us of the hadith from Sahih Muslim, where the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "What means Allah does not look at your bodies nor at your appearances, but He looks at your hearts and actions," right? That's what counts. It doesn't mean how beautiful you look, how affluent you are, how popular you may be, in your society, but what is the state of your heart, and how much action do you have to back that up, right? That is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking at. That's what counts. Ma'wahum, their abode, their place, their destination, their place of residence, towards which they are working, is Jahannam, which is more horrid than can ever be humanly imagined. Okay, let's look at 96. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Yahlifuna, they swear lakum, to you or before you, litardaw, in order to please anhum, so that you may become pleased anhum, upon them or with them. Fa'in, so if tardaw, you become pleased anhum, upon them or with them. فَإِنَّ اللَّهُ, so indeed Allah, لا يرضى, does not become pleased, عن القوم الفاسقين, عن, about القوم, عن, with regards to القوم, a people, الفاسقين, who are فاسقين. 96, they will swear to you in order to please you, but even if you become pleased with them, Allah will not be pleased with such an evil-doing people. Okay, so another reason they swear to you or before you is to please you, is to make you happy with them. But regardless of that, even if you become pleased with them, Allah is not going to accept their excuses if they somehow manage to convince you, because as we're going to see even later on, they had become experts in their nifaq. They had become such experts, so convincing, that it was so hard to not fall for it. It was so hard to, you know, not believe them. So even if they somehow manage to convince you or to please you, Allah will never become pleased with such a fasiq people, with such a rebellious people, right? So they want to have you become happy with them or become complacent, at least so that you would continue to treat them as Muslims, right? So that they could, you know, keep their interests in this dunya secure, that all Muslims enjoyed, right, under the banner of Islam in Medina. And again, this shows how afraid the munafiqin really were at their cover being blown, how their naked nifaq would become exposed at any moment. And this quality of fear that the hypocrites had is actually mentioned in Surah Al-Hashr as well, verse 13, لا أنتم أشد رهبة في صدورهم من الله ذلك بأنهم قوم لا يفقهون, which means indeed there is more fear in their hearts for you, yani for the believers, than there is for Allah. That is because there are people who do not understand, right? An indication of being a person who lacks understanding, who lacks true fiqh, true understanding of matters, is that they would fear the people more than they would fear Allah. This is an indication of a person's comprehension, his or her fear of Allah or the lack thereof, right? And so here they're described in this verse 96 as a people of fisq. Because one who, and again, we've mentioned the meaning of fisq many times. Fisq, a fasiq, is a rebellious person who goes beyond the bounds, who transgresses beyond what is prescribed, goes beyond the limits perpetually, habitually. Okay, so one who does not have fear in their hearts, one who does not have fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that has greater fear of people compared to the fear of Allah in their hearts, when that basic ingredient in the heart is missing, that taqwa of Allah is missing in the heart, then we cannot expect to have correctness of action in the body, right? If a person, you know, doesn't have the right components making up his, you know, a spirituality in the center of his being, which is his heart, the most fundamental of which is taqwa of Allah, then how can there possibly be correctness of action, right? When that basis is missing. So then what are they characterized by? Not by taqwa, not by correctness of action. So there is excessiveness in their actions, which is essentially what fisq is related to. Excessiveness, transgression, going beyond the bounds in sinfulness habitually as a habit. Okay, let's look at verse 97. Al-A'rabu, the A'rab, referring to the Bedouins, ashaddu, greater or more intense, kufra, in their kufr or disbelief, wa and nifaqan, in their hypocrisy, wa ajdaru, and are more likely or most likely, alla, to not, this is made up of two words, an and la, ya'lamu, and more likely to not know, ya'lamu from alima, to not know, hududa, the limits, ma, that, anzalallah, Allah has revealed, ala, upon, rasulihi, his messenger, wallahu, and Allah, alimun, all-knowing, hakim, all-wise. 97. The Bedouin Arabs surpass all in unbelief and hypocrisy, and are most likely to be unaware of the limits prescribed by Allah in what he has revealed to his messenger. Allah is all-knowing, all-wise. Okay, so here, this really very interesting analysis of the Bedouin Arabs coming up here in this verse and in the following verse. And here the mention is made of a group of Bedouin Arabs who are removed from civilization. They are not living in Medina, right? They don't have, you know, that the culture of Medina or the knowledge that obviously is in the place of revelation. And nor do they have many means in their desert setting to attain knowledge. Maududi rahimahullah ta'ala writes in describing them, these Bedouins are more hypocritical than the urban Arabs and are more stubborn and obdurate in their denial of the truth. This is because the urban people make use of the opportunities of meeting the learned and pious people and thus learn the laws and regulations of the true way. On the other hand, in all probability, the Bedouins will learn little about the divine way because they get few opportunities for this. Moreover, they lead lives of economic animals rather than of human beings, having moral and spiritual values. Therefore, they do not think of higher things than their animal urges. So these desert Bedouin Arabs have a very rudimentary lifestyle. They are engaged and occupied in the basics of survival. They are removed from the centers of learning and civilization, so they have far less opportunity to acquaint themselves with revelation and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed. And he also says, because the Bedouin Arabs, one thing we have to realize is that the message of Islam did reach them, right? They did know about Islam and they did have a chance to respond. And respond they did, right? But how did they respond? Maududi writes, these people had outwardly embraced Islam. They had not done so from conviction. When they saw the rise of the organized power of Islam in Al-Madina, they were so overawed by it that they could not ignore it. When the power of the Islamic government spread over the major portions of Hijaz and Najd and the power of its enemy clans began to decline, they thought it expedient to enter the fold of Islam. But there were very few among them who had sincerely accepted Islam from the conviction that it was the right way. That is why they did not make any sincere efforts to fulfill the implications of the true faith and observe the fard duties imposed by Islam. On the contrary, most of them had accepted Islam just because it was the best policy for them. They merely desired to take advantages of being Muslims in order to gain those benefits to which they were entitled as members of the ruling party, referring to the Party of Islam, without performing those duties which became fard on them because of that acceptance. Therefore, they were utterly averse to saying the prescribed prayers, to fasting, to pay the zakat, so on and so forth. Okay, so this was the situation where they had accepted Islam outwardly, but it was more so for the plunders and war spoils that they were interested in, rather than to actually sacrifice and serve the deen as was necessary at that time. So whenever it was time to serve, whenever the need for sacrifice arose, they would invent one excuse or another to get out of it. But there was no sincerity really inside of them, nor was there any justification for the excuses that they gave. So what this resulted in is that they became very coarse. They were already coarse because of their environment and living conditions and few opportunities for learning. And that coarseness then got meshed with the nifaq, the hypocrisy. And when there is no sincerity to truly, you know, become Muslim, you know, how much learning can possibly take place? So then there was ignorance compounding the entire situation. So this was a very, really debilitating, spiritually debilitating state to be in, right? And here in this verse, we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala characterizes them as being ashaddu kufra wa nifaqa, most intense in their kufr, in their disbelief and their nifaq, and their hypocrisy, and that they're most likely to be ignorant of the hudud, the prescribed limits that Allah has revealed to His Messenger, because they are distant from revelation. Sheikh Saadi, he compares the two types of Arabs, the Bedouin desert-dwelling Arab and the city Arab, right? And he says, the desert Arab, this is parenthetical introduction, the desert Arab is more likely to be ignorant of the, he says, fundamentals of Iman and rulings or commandments and prohibitions, opposed to the city-dwelling Arab, who is more likely to know the, to have knowledge of the hudud Allah has revealed to His Prophet. And the city-dwelling Arab has, you know, the correct concepts, good concepts, again, related to the deen because of where he lives. And therefore, these breed intentions for khair. And intentions then actually turn to actions. While this is not the case for the desert dweller. And of course, the city Arab, you know, mixes with the people of Iman. And, you know, you will find the phenomena of nifaq, hypocrisy, in both settings, in the city of Medina as well as in the deserts. But it is more intense in the desert, right? And from the manifestations of its intensity is the greedy nature that the Bedouins exhibited. They were extremely eager for wealth, and they were extremely stingy when it came to having to give, spend their wealth in the way of Allah, or even giving the zakah, as we'll see. Now, what is the lesson in all of this for us? You know, I thought this was screaming out to me about the enormous impact of where we choose to live, where we choose to raise our families, the environment that we plant ourselves and our families and our children in. It has a massive, almost irreversible impact on our personalities and on the tarbiyah of our children. And, you know, think about being in a good, strong Muslim communities, the opportunities for khair that are naturally presented because of the location, right? The community masjid interaction, and perhaps the biggest, the suhbah saliha, right? The righteous companionship, the opportunity to be able to meet with righteous individuals and interact with them and to allow yourself to become positively influenced by them. I mean, that is huge and it is really irreplaceable. Now, think about the hijrah. Why was the hijrah fard? Why did you have to leave Mecca and go to Medina, right? I mean, Mecca was not just a place where the Muslims were, you know, being tortured. They couldn't practice their deen. They couldn't survive. They had to make the hijrah for those reasons. But Medina is not just about surviving. It was about thriving. It was, Allah just doesn't want us to get by and just to, you know, survive as barely Muslim. He wants us to thrive spiritually and, you know, excel onto the levels of ihsan. And that takes a village. It takes an entire community. It takes an entire establishment. And that's what Medina was, right? It's not just fearfully praying in your homes in a corner, you know, in Mecca or in Darul Arqam, but it is for Bilal to be able to ascend, you know, to the highest house and call out the adhan out loud, to let that ring through the streets of Medina, to let that call tug at the strings of your heart so that the believer is moved to leave that which occupies him or her at home or in the marketplace and to rush to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The community impact, you know, that a environment like that has, you know, cannot be compared to a private experience of Islam, to a private Islam. So it's not just, you know, being a Muslim privately in the confines of your four walls, but to be able to freely express that and to experience that publicly, you know, in confidently in a public Islam setting where there are emblems and signs visible for us to see and to benefit from. And for those of you that have visited modern Istanbul, know what I'm talking about when I talk about what it feels like to experience the richness of a public communal Islam, right? So the point being, the lesson for us being is where you live, where you choose to live, can put you at a great advantage or a severe disadvantage with regards to how beautifully you can live and learn your deen and interact with its adherents and the righteous companionship. I cannot overemphasize and how much deprivation there is to be suffered conversely on the account of your choice of residence, right? So, you know, when you buy property, just a rule of real estate is look for three things when buying property. They'll tell you look for three top things: location, 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 right? So the same really holds true, you know, from an Islamic perspective when it comes to nurturing your deen, your own spirituality, raising your family, doing their tarbiyah. Choose a location that serves your values, that works for you, not against you, not an environment that undermines all the hard work you're trying to do at home. Okay, let's look at 98. Wa and min, from al-A'rab, the Bedouin Arabs, man, who, yattakhidhu, takes, ma, that, yunfiqu, he spends, maghraman, a fine. Wa and yatarabbasu, waits, bikum, with regards to you, ad-dawa'ir, misfortunes. Alayhim, upon them, da'iratu, the misfortune or ill, da'iratu, so the fortune of evil, so misfortune, asu, evil. Wallahu, and Allah, sami'an, alim, sami'an, all hearing, alim, all knowing. 98. And among the Bedouin Arabs, there are such as regard whatever they spend, yani in the way of Allah, as a fine, and wait for some misfortune to befall you. May ill fortune befall them. Allah is all hearing, all knowing. Okay. So here we see in this verse that this group of Bedouin Arabs that is being referred to is a group that is quite averse to the deen and to its dictates. since Islam had come to the region, they had accepted it again outwardly. But nifaq, hypocrisy, was what characterized them inwardly, right? And since their hearts were not behind their profession of faith, then the various commandments of Islam were unbearable to them, right? How can you sacrifice for a cause you don't believe in? And so they would consider the zakat they had to give, the sadaqah, whatever they had to spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would consider that as a fine against themselves, as if they were being unjustly punished. The word maghram, which is used here in the verse, is a fine that you have to pay for something that's not your fault. So, you know, it shows how they really felt this was unjust. Like Ibn Kathir mentions, they looked at it as a loss and a burden, the financial contribution that they had to make. And Maududi rahimahullah ta'ala, he writes, this means that they regarded the payment of zakah dues as a fine and the expenditure on hospitality, which is an Islamic duty, a penalty. Likewise, if they had to make any contributions towards jihad, they did so to show their loyalty to the Islamic State and not because they wanted to please Allah by giving sincere monetary help for his cause. Okay, so this shows where their hearts were, and not just when it came to spending money, but also with regards to you, O Muslims, they wait for you dawa'ir. Dawa'ir is from dawr. Dawr is a turn or a cycle. So this refers to the turn of events, but it refers to those turn of events, those change, that change in circumstance which goes from good to bad. So a previously good circumstance changes into a bad circumstance or bad situation. So like good fortune turning into ill fortune. So actually these Bedouins are hoping that you, O Muslims, are afflicted by bad fortune after all this good luck that you've been having, and Islam is victorious, and you know the circle of shirk and mushrikeen is shrinking. They're hoping that those days of shirk and jahiliyyah would come back again, right? That bad days would fall upon you after, you know, your experience of these good days. So that's what they're waiting for. تَرَبَّصُ بِكُمَ الدَّوَائِرِ. They're waiting for dawa'ir, for this change of fortunes to come and turn events to overtake you and to change that victory of Islam into victory for shirk, so that that old system would return. This was the state of their hearts. This is what they're inwardly wishing for while they're outwardly saying La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. So this is why Surah At-Tawbah is called Al-Fadhiha, right? The that which exposes, right? It really exposed the inner state of hypocrisy that was there. Okay, let's look at verse 99. Wa and min al-A'rab, from the A'rab, from the Bedouins, man who yu'minu, believes billah, in Allah, wal yawm al-akhir, and the day, the last, and the last day, wa yattakhidhu, and takes ma, that yunfiqu, he spends, yani takes that which he spends, yani regards that which he spends, qurubat, a means of nearness, plural of qurba, a closeness, qurubat, closenesses, yani means of closeness, عند الله, to Allah, wa salawat al-rasul, wa and salawat, plural of salah, which in its linguistic meaning means dua or prayer, yani invocations. Al-rasul, and the prayers of the rasul, yani a source of dua of the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ala, indeed, innaha, indeed, it, qurbatul lahum, qurba, a means of closeness, lahum, for them. Sayudkhiluhum Allah, seen, shall, yudkhilu, enter, whom, they, Allah. Allah will enter them, fi, in, rahmati, his mercy. Inna Allah ghafur rahim, inna, indeed, Allah, ghafur, the most forgiving, rahim, the most merciful. Verse 99. And among the Bedouin Arabs are those who believe in Allah and the last day and regard their spending in the way of Allah as a means of drawing near to Allah and of deserving the prayers of the messenger. Indeed, this shall be a means of drawing near to Allah. Allah will surely admit them to His mercy. Allah is all forgiving, all merciful, right? So all the Bedouin Arabs are not alike. There are different groups, there are different types. There are those among them who have sincerely believed, and they have proven that with their spending, but with good intentions. They have done it so that it would be a means of closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a means, a way of getting the dua of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? Because he used to make dua for the ones who would give in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So note, there is no blanket condemnation of all the desert Arabs or the Bedouins per se. Rather, factors have been pointed out that contributed to which way the two groups went, right? Yes, they were away from the center of wahi, and it was a factor if you let that turn the invitation of Islam into something you would reject and become hypocrites. But there was another way to respond to that same invitation. There was another choice that could have been made, which the people in this verse that have been praised by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala indeed made. They made the choice to believe, right? As some of you who are familiar with the seven habits of highly effective people, one of the great points that the book makes is that between stimulus and response, we have the great freedom of choice, the great freedom of choosing. So these were two groups within the same setting. They're all desert-dwelling Bedouin Arabs, and they were presented with the stimulus, with the invitation to Islam, and then they had the full choice to respond as they liked. And here we see these people sincerely accepted the invitation to Iman. And so, yes, they are also physically removed from the midst of revelation, but once it came before them, once they came to know about it, because their hearts were in the right place, they accepted and became sincere Muslims. And they would spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a very different intention, because remember the other group of Bedouin Arabs also used to spend in the way of Allah, but they treated that maghraman, as a maghram, as a fine, something they did grudgingly, something they thought was being taken from them unjustly. They did not want to part with that wealth, right? But here, in this case, they spent with the intention of it being a means of nearness to Allah, a means of getting the dua of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Remember when Abdurrahman bin Auf brought the of his wealth for the expedition of Tabuk, the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam made dua for him, right? That was a sunnah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he would make dua for those that would spend and bring forth for the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we saw the barakah that Abdurrahman bin Auf had till the end of his life and beyond. So Ibn Kathir mentions how they will attain what they sought. They will get that nearness that they are seeking through that spending. So the lesson for us is that indeed we will be treated according to our intentions. Yani, we'll get out of our worship what we're intending thereby. You know, when we're praying in the masjid or at home, when we are fasting extra for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we are giving sadaqah, when we're making dua, doing istighfar, if we're seeking Allah's nearness through these things, then it will become that nearness. It will actually, Allah will accept it and transform it and make it that means of nearness. It will in effect become something that draws you closer to Him. So, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ. Again, the first hadith we learn about, that indeed actions are by intentions, right? You will get out of your deed the intention that you put into it. If we are doing something and intending to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is going to happen, inshallah. So we must be conscious. That is the take-home lesson for us, right? Sheikh Saadi mentions in his tafsir that, this type of approach, doing things consciously and intending Allah's nearness thereby is what gets a person everything that they want. You get the closeness to Allah, you get the increase in your wealth if you're spending for the sake of Allah, it will only increase your wealth, inshallah, and barakah in your life that will come from, you know, having accepted iman and then living it practically. So the take home is to live out our deen consciously. Be conscious of your worship, be conscious of your deeds. Don't worship out of routine or habit. You know, if you look at the word in Arabic for habit, it's aada, and the word in Arabic for worship is ibadah, right? The difference between aada, habit, and ibadah, worship, is intention, right? If someone gets up in the morning and washes his, you know, or her face and arms and feet, have they done wudu? If that intention is not there, then it is not wudu, right? So something that you would do out of habit, a habitual cleaning, versus wudu, which you get sins wiped for, which becomes a source of light and recognition on the Day of Judgment. The difference between the same act, that empowering difference and distinction and elevation, is through the intention. So, you know, let us always try to maximize the deed, even if it is small and you're doing it anyway and it's part of your routine. Maximize it through the grandness of intention, right? And you can turn something small into something grand without lifting a finger, just by that renewal of conscious intention in your heart. And how does an intention become grand? When it is sincere, when it is earnest, when it is only for Allah, and humbly asking Him, making dua to Him to make the little that we offer abundant on His scales, right? اجعل القليل عندنا كثير عندك, right? To make the small that is with us كثير, abundant on the scales with Him when we meet Him, right? So for these people, Allah is promising entry into His mercy, right? Because that is the nature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is forgiving, He is merciful. So there's so much to be hopeful for in our deen. Our deen is not a deen of gloom and doom. It is a deen of hope and mercy and forgiveness, as long as the heart is in the right place and the actions are according to inshallah the sunnah of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That, of course, effort has to be there to do our deeds of devotion according to the sunnah of our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was sent for that purpose, to show us how to worship, right? So really, there's so much to look forward to with such a glorious, forgiving and loving Lord that we have, alhamdulillah. And I just want to summarize some of the amazing points from Sheikh Saadi's tafsir with regards to this verse. He says some of the, you know, beneficial points we can take away are, number one, kufr and nifaq, yani disbelief and hypocrisy, increase and decrease according to the circumstances, right? Again, the environmental factors that we mentioned, and some can be more damaging to some people, while others may be able to, you know, withstand their blow and still excel. So we have to see where we are. Are we leaders or followers? Number two, the superiority of knowledge is also really highlighted in this verse, because it mentions how the desert dwelling Arabs were more intense in their kufr and nifaq, and more likely to not know the hudud, the boundaries of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So that really points to the superiority of knowledge, of knowing, and that the one who doesn't have access to that knowledge is closer to, you know, evil, or being disadvantaged, being at a disadvantage to themselves from an Islamic perspective. Number three, the most beneficial type of knowledge is that of the hudud of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that of the boundaries of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the halal and the haram, right? And Sheikh Saadi mentions a term, an interesting term he calls them the hudud of iman. He calls them the boundaries of faith, right? The limits or the prescribed limits or boundaries of faith. And he talks about Islam and ihsan and taqwa and the concept of success and obedience. And he has a long list of things. And knowing what is haram, zina, khamr, riba. So, you know, if you look at this whole list, it really is the tarbiyah of Islam, the hudud of iman. You know, it's things that all of us have to know about, be schooled in, be educated about, in order to have the imprint of a Muslim, in order to look Muslim and, you know, think Muslim and act Muslim. We have to have a knowledge of these you know, concepts that we just mentioned. So perhaps this is why he calls them the hudud of iman, because within these hudud, within these boundaries, you get the picture, you get the map, you know, of what a Muslim is, you know, made up of, what a Muslim should look like and think like and act like, right? And number four, he mentions how the believer is obligated to discharge his or her obligations cheerfully, willingly, with an open heart, with a satisfied soul, eager to get its profit, yani its benefit, and to not regard it as a fine against themselves, right? That was the great contrast between one group versus the other. The group of Bedouins who regarded that which they had to spend to keep up their claim to Islam believable, right? They considered that as maghram, as a fine, something they did, but did it unwillingly, grudgingly, without believing in it, right? So could it possibly count for them? Could it possibly bring them any benefit? Versus the one who spends, and what is he or she seeking? Qurubat and عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَصَلَوَاتِ الرَّسُولِ, right? Seeking that qurba, seeking that, making it, regarding it, doing it in order to get that nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, you know, being able to reap that profit. So the take home for us from this point is that let us be cheerful Muslims, okay? We should not be burdened under the various commandments of Islam. We should not be burdened under the various duties Allah has imposed on us as Muslims, because they were supposed to be uplifting. So if there's something wrong with how we feel, or if we feel burdened towards the obligations, then we have to look at our priorities. That means my energy is being used up somewhere else. So by the time I get to that which Allah has made fard, I have no more energy or willingness, you know, left to spend it cheerfully on those tasks. Once I remember someone who was really overwhelmed in Ramadan by fasting and exhausted, you know, even within a few days of the month, because of the work schedule that, you know, they had to keep up. And this was a person who did not have to work at that time, right? So they were very wisely instructed by their parent that Allah did not ask you to work, but He asked you to fast, right? So I understand that some of us do have to work, but if we are in a situation where that is a choice, and our deen, our fara'id, are being compromised or impacted, then we have to take a hard look at ourselves, our priorities, our choices. Where do we choose to expend our energy, our freshness? And what is it that, you know, is left over of that, that, you know, when we face our Islamic obligations, you know, we feel burdened by those. So this is something that we have to kind of ask ourselves. Okay. Let's do one more verse, verse 100. والسابقون, and the foremost, الأولون, again the first. من ال, from المهاجرين, the مهاجرين, والأنصار, and the أنصار. The مهاجرين, of course, are the immigrants from Mecca. The أنصار are, of course, the people of Medina. والذين, and those, والذين اتبعوهم, who followed them بإحسان, with excellence. رضي الله عنهم, Allah is pleased with them, waradu, and they are pleased anhu, with him, wa and adda, he has prepared lahum, for them, jannat, gardens, tajri, flow, tahtaha, under it, al anhar, the rivers, khalidina, forever, khalidina, eternally, fiha, in it, abada, forever, dhalika, that, al fawz, the success, al azim, the greatest. Verse 100. And of those who led the way, the first of the Muhajirin and the Ansar, and those who followed them in the best possible manner. Allah is well pleased with them, and they are well pleased with Allah. He has prepared for them gardens beneath which rivers flow. Therein they will abide forever. That is the supreme triumph. Okay. So the foremost, those who were first, those who were in the front lines from the Muhajirin and the Ansar, the first Muslims, or those who sacrificed in the beginning days of Islam, the Ansar, and then those who followed their example in the best way, these are the ones that Allah is pleased with, and they are pleased with Allah. And for them, He has prepared eternal gardens, delightful rivers. Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions that the foremost of the Muhajirin and the Ansar are those who conducted the pledge of Ridwan in the year of Hudaybiyah. And others have said that they are those who performed the prayers towards both Qiblas with the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. First, as you know, we pray towards, the Muslims pray towards Baytul Maqdis, Jerusalem, and then towards the Kaaba in Mecca, right? So you'll find various opinions on who the Sabiqun al-Awwalun are, the first and the foremost among the Muhajirin and the Ansar. If you look at the word as-Sabiqun, which is plural of Sabiq, literally means one who gets ahead, right? One who gets ahead. And for those who study in our HIRS program with us, you know, the Sabaq is the lesson that we give. And it's from the same root word, which means, you know, when you recite your sabak, your lesson to your teacher, it's like you have advanced one more step, right? So it's someone who gets ahead. So if you do that every week, you're getting ahead every week. So those who were in the front of the race, those who were the foremost believers from the Muhajirin and the Ansar, these are the ones who have attained the highest success. And the emphasis on eternity in this ayah, it's something that's repeated over and over, right? Khalidina, eternally, therein, abada, forever. So khalidin, eternally, abada, forever, it's really the same meaning, right? But just emphasized, repeated to, you know, highlight how it is a continuous, permanent state of success. No one who enters paradise will ever be evicted from it. No one gets out of paradise. Once you are there, once you make it, you are there forever and ever. And subhanAllah, you know, eternity is a concept that just really boggles the mind. It's something we cannot comprehend as limited human beings. You know, we're used to everything coming to an end. That's part of being residents of Earth, right? Earth is temporary. We're used to, you know, the concept of temporary, you know, state of things, and everything has a beginning and it has an end. Times of difficulty also end, right? Just like good times and fun times and celebrations end. And then it is only their memory that remains for us in this world. And then a longing for those good times accompanies, you know, their memory. Sometimes this turns into a painful nostalgia. Sometimes this turns into a stinging regret for things past. The point being that joy on earth, even the most intense joy, even the longest periods of joy on earth, are ultimately followed by pain, because they come to an end, right? So anything that ends, you know, just thinking about the fact that it's going to end, no matter how joyous the day is or the occasion is, knowing that it's going to end is like a painful aspect to that joy. So even the concept or experience of joy in dunya is intrinsically tainted and flawed by the fact that it has an end, right? But this is completely opposed to the eternal nature of the akhirah, right? That abode of perfection is a place where the feelings of joy are also perfect, where the joy is experienced perfectly, completely, and part of its perfection and completeness and intensity is that it will never come to an end. So it's perfect and eternal and complete in that sense, right? Feelings of complete unending joy, youth that shall never ever fade, clothes that shall never ever wear out, right? Never ending pleasures. So I thought I would highlight that aspect of khalidina fiha, forever and ever abiding therein. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all the inhabitants of Jannat al-Firdaus al-A'la. May Allah make easy for us those deeds that get us close to Jannat al-Firdaus and take us away from those deeds that take us away from that abode of endless eternal joy. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdika la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Inshallah, that concludes our session for this week. I hope to see you all next Wednesday, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.
Qad azamat fa lil amjad baniha wa man yasa ila al aliyatuha bima fiha wa yabni majdahu jadilan فروح الفائها ليصبح همّا